basically have no moral boundaries. Whatever feels good to them at the moment, that's what they do. So atheism is dangerous insofar as you see people that adopt that worldview, they have no moral boundaries. Okay, my name is Jesse Romero. Welcome to tonight's Bible study. This is part two of how to answer an atheist, or you can even call it atheism, the fool's gospel. That's what I choose to call it, atheism, the fool's gospel. And this is part two of our adult education. As Catholics, whenever we respond to anything, we use several things. We use faith, and we use reason, and we use common sense. So there's a threefold way of responding as a Catholic. You use faith, the biblical revelation given to us by God's word. You use reason, and you use common sense. That's what we call apologetics, how to give reasonable answers to people that ask us questions about our faith. So let's begin in a prayer in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for rising from the dead and for giving us hope. And to know, Lord, that we are a resurrected people, Lord, an Easter people. We know that every single Sunday in the Catholic Church, we celebrate the resurrection, the victory of Jesus Christ over sin, death, hell, and the grave. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for giving us hope, because now we know beyond a shadow of a doubt, with full certainty, that there's life after death, because you, Lord, have risen. And you've come back to tell us that, yes, there is life after death. And you, Lord Jesus Christ, have demonstrated that you have power and victory over death itself. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for so great a salvation that you have wrought for the world. We thank you, Lord, in the name of the Father, Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, part two, atheism, the fool's gospel. What is atheism? Atheism is an ideology where people believe that there's no God. Atheism, there is no God. Atheists are people that don't believe there's a God. Last Bible study, part one, you saw the way we tackled some of the ways you can respond to an atheist using reason, using logic. Today we're going to go through part two. We're going to use some scientific arguments to argue against our militant atheist opponents. An atheist will say there's no God. Well, for something to be known as science, it has to be testable, observable, verifiable, and empirical. And atheism doesn't meet the fourfold tests of science. Therefore, people that say that there's no God, that's their opinion. It's not scientific. They cannot prove that statement. Take a look at the notes that I prepared for you tonight, and I'm going to show you some science. Okay? I, as a Catholic Bible teacher, am going to appeal to science to demonstrate, using science, not the scriptures, that atheism is a fool's gospel. For somebody to say there is no God, that statement is a statement of faith. That's not a statement of fact. How do we know? Take a look at my notes that I prepared for you. There is a scientific law. It's called the first law of thermodynamics. Write in your notes. So what is the first law of thermodynamics? This is the law of energy conservation, stating that energy can be converted from one form to another, but it cannot be created or destroyed. Did you catch that? See what science teaches? This is a scientific law, the first law of thermodynamics. It says energy cannot be created or destroyed. The first law of thermodynamics teaches that the universe did not create itself. There is no scientific principle for matter or energy bringing itself into existence from nothing, and it has never been observed. Energy cannot be created or destroyed. It is scientifically impossible. Yet, the Big Bang Theory proposes that the entire universe brought itself into existence as a first particle and then explode it into everything that exists today, all by natural means alone. The Big Bang Theory essentially starts with the proposition that first a miracle happened. A naturalistic explanation of the origin of the universe certainly requires a miracle, but no one has offered any natural cause explanation that does not violate the first law of thermodynamics, which teaches that the universe did not create itself. That's a scientific law, because energy cannot be created or destroyed. The first basic principle of evolution, therefore, rests on unscientific grounds. So here's another argument that non-believers will use. They'll say, well, we think that things came about through spontaneous generation. That's another argument they'll throw, because the argument that the universe was created out of nothing, when you say to them, what you just said is not scientific. Gotcha. You just violated the first law of thermodynamics. So then they say, okay, this Catholic knows a little bit about science. Okay. We know how it all came about. Spontaneous generation. That's a word that they just pulled out of a rabbit's hat. So what is it? The spontaneous generation of life on Earth by natural means has never been observed in a laboratory. Life only comes from life. This is called the law of biogenesis. So, when your college liberal friend says, we think life came about, the origins of life came about through spontaneous generation, you respond to them as a Catholic, very interesting. Spontaneous generation of life has never, ever, ever been observed in a scientific laboratory test. So what atheists argue is myths, M-Y-T-H-S, not science. I'm giving you science. I'm demonstrating to you that science, hardcore science, militates against atheism. Let's look at the last line that I put there in my notes. Life comes only from life. This is called the law of biogenesis. Okay? So, when your atheist friend says, we just think that life came from, it came out of, nothing, and all of a sudden it came to be. Well, that goes against science. What scientific law? It's right there in the notes. The law of biogenesis states life comes only from life. So every single argument that the atheist uses is unscientific. I've given them to you in my notes. These notes are gold right here. First law of thermodynamics, right there I define it for you. Spontaneous generation and law of biogenesis. All argue against atheism. Let's continue. Is it not significant that no man has ever been able to make living matter from non-living matter? Only God can. Think about it. On this basis, the Catholic Church teaches as proof for the existence of God what St. Thomas calls the need for a first cause, God. And this philosophical statement that there is a need for a first cause, this is supported by the law of thermodynamics. Let's look at what the Bible says, okay? You'll see that the Bible and the law of first God, the first cause, is congruent with each other. The Bible and science here is congruent with each other, okay? The law, the need for a first cause basically means that all of life comes from something. There has to be something that self-exists, self-subsists, is not dependent on anything. We call that God. And then everything stems from that. So that God is the first cause, and everything else needs that first cause to exist and to continue in existence. That's the argument. Okay? Well, guess what? This is supported by the first law of thermodynamics. The first law of thermodynamics teaches that the universe did not create itself. That matter can't come from nothing. It has to come from something. Look what the Bible says in Romans 4:17. I put it there. Okay? As it is written, quote, God gives life to the dead and calls into being what does not exist. Wow. Look what the Bible says about God. God gives life to the dead and calls into being what does not exist. So the Bible argues that there needs to be a first cause. What's that first cause? God. Science wants you to believe that, for example, imagine a tornado that blows into a junkyard. And at the end of the tornado, you get a nice Lamborghini. Beautiful custom Lamborghini with a beautiful paint job and all decked out. Are you kidding? How many of you, look at how unscientific atheism is. They want to tell you that, oh, from this explosion that was caused by, who knows, we don't know who caused it, this big bang, you get everything out there, all the order and design and the beauty of the universe. That's unscientific. Let me ask you a question. And you can do this in a laboratory over and over. Every time you explode something, you don't get order. You always get chaos. Get an M80. Get a stick of dynamite. Okay? Get a Piccolo Pete. Get a firecracker from Tijuana. Okay? Every time you explode something, explosions cause chaos. 100% of the times. Yet the atheists want you to believe that this explosion called the Big Bang brought in perfect order. The Grand Canyon, Niagara Falls, the Milky Way. They take us for fools because explosions always, 100% of the time, cause disorder. So this explosion, the Big Bang, atheists, so who caused the Big Bang? You don't know. Well, there's a need for a first cause. We call the person who caused the Big Bang God. And because he's God, instead of chaos coming out of that Big Bang, when he spoke creation and everything leapt into existence like a puzzle, when God spoke through his creative word, God, because he's goodness, beauty, and truth itself, everything was ordered. Everything had intricacy and aesthetic beauty. Because as it says in Romans 4:17, look at that Bible verse again. God gives life to the dead and calls into being what does not exist. Look at the next Bible verse I put there. 2 Maccabees 7:28. I beseech you, my child, to look at the heavens and the earth and see everything that is in them. And recognize that God did not make them out of things that existed. Thus, also mankind comes into being. The Bible says that God made everything that we see not out of things that existed. God did not have to go to, you know, Sam's Club or Home Depot and buy nails and wood and plaster and stuff to create things. God spoke. And everything, as he spoke, leapt into existence. He's the only one that can do that. Because he's God. Let's look at another scientific law I have in my notes there. The second law of thermodynamics. And how this vindicates the Catholic position and the way this argues against atheists. The second law of thermodynamics is the law of energy decay. It states that every system left to its own devices, moves from order to disorder, where the universe is moving in a downward direction of decreasing organization. Some would like to imagine that matter is self-organizing and could have formed life from non-living compounds, but this has never been observed. The scientific law essentially states that the disorder, what science calls entropy, in a system always increases. Let me give you an example. All you have to do is stop watering your nice green lawn for a week during the hottest summer month, and you will see the second law of thermodynamics at work. Your grass will decay because all matter tends towards decomposition. In every system, energy is always being wasted and cannot be recovered. Yet, the theory of evolution teaches that a simple organism evolved into a highly integrated, complex organism like a human being. This theory flies against the face of the second law of thermodynamics, which teaches that everything tends towards decomposition. And yet, the theory of evolution, which is going against fixed science, wants to say that, again, that a simple organism evolved into a highly integrated, complex organism called a human being. Impossible. That's never happened before. Matter doesn't become more sophisticated and doesn't reach higher levels. Matter disintegrates. All matter. It's a fixed scientific law. It's like the law of gravity. If I throw a brick over my head, it's going to hit my head. It's going to come right down on my head. It's a fixed scientific law. Therefore, take a look at my notes here. Therefore, another proof of the existence of God is the need for an intelligent designer. And this is supported by the second law of thermodynamics. Look what the Bible says about the need for an intelligent designer. John chapter 1, verse 3. The Bible says about Jesus Christ, it says, all things were made by him, that's Jesus, and without him was not anything made that was made. So the Bible argues that Jesus is this intelligent designer that gave us all the aesthetic beauty that we see, all the highly integrated organizational complexity that we see in the universe and even in the human person. Look what the Bible says in Genesis 1:1. It says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. How did God create? He spoke. And when God speaks, his word is so powerful that as he speaks, the thing that he speaks, it leaps into existence, or it morphs into existence. Psalm 139, verses 13 and 17. Look what the Bible says about the way God, he forms things very complex, very intricately. Psalm 139, verse 13 and 17. The Bible says, this is King David writing about God. He says, you formed my inmost being. You knit me in my mother's womb. How precious to me are your designs. How vast the sum of them. In Acts chapter 17, verse 28, look what the Bible tells us about our relationship with God. It says, for in him, that's God, we live and move and have our being. You know what that means? That means none of you right now can even breathe. Do you know that if God right now, if God stopped thinking about you right now personally, you'd drop dead right in that pew. As you sit there breathing and your heart is beating, God sustains you minute by minute, second by second, nanosecond by nanosecond, millisecond by millisecond. The moment God stops thinking about you and actively sustaining you, you will die. Your days are numbered. There is nothing you can do, Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6, to add one more day to your life or to detract one more day. See, when you start realizing who you are and who God is, then you say, yep, I got to worship him. I want to be his friend. I want to stay close to him. Without God, we are absolutely nothing. You know what we are without God? You've all seen a corpse. You know what a corpse is? It used to be a human being with a soul. What's a human being? A human being is a body-soul composite. Body-soul composite. Boom. That's called a human person. Why can I move and throw my hands up in the air and roll my eyes back? Because I have a soul. When God says, that's it, I'm going to judge you, come here now. My soul will leave my body and I will drop dead wherever God calls me. Death is, the definition of death, is the separation of the soul from the body. And then the body starts decomposing into its composite body parts. Let's go back to the notes here. It's interesting that the word universe means uni, in Latin means one. Verse in Latin means a line of a song, a canticle or poetry. The Jews teach, the rabbis teach, that when God spoke words, creation leapt into existence as music played in the background. I found that kind of interesting when reading some of the rabbinic literature, that as God spoke everything into creation in the Genesis chapter 1 account, that the rabbis tell us that music was playing in the background as God was creating everything out of nothing. Let's look at another section here. Science speaks out against atheism. Okay? Studies suggest life sprang from clay. This came out, Washington, Reuters, news agency, October 25th, 2003. It says, science backed up religion this week in a study that suggests life may have indeed sprung from clay, just as many faiths teach. This scientific article supports the supernatural creation model that we find in the book of Genesis. You can read that article on your own. Basically, science is saying, you know what? Based on super DNA testing, it's very plausible that everything came from a lump of clay. So science is now validating the Genesis account. World's most famous atheist accepts the existence of God, and he cites modern science. The best known atheist of the last 50 years, his name's Professor Anthony Flew. He made the announcement a couple of years ago in a symposium on science and religion that the discoveries of modern science have led him to accept the existence of God. Last December, the news was made public that Professor Anthony Flew, the world's most famous philosopher of atheism, had become a believer that there is a supernatural or spiritual force active in this magnificent world of ours. The reaction in the world press was monumental. It ranged from, what a courageous person to be willing to change opinion in light of the facts, to, he's been duped. Professor Flew said that the main driving force for his dramatic change in belief was the information he read in a book called The Hidden Face of God. It's a book written by Roy Varghese, who's, by the way, a very faithful Catholic scientist. So he had an impact. He wrote a book. And this atheist... In fact, let me tell you a little bit about Anthony Flew. This is huge. Anthony Flew was the most famous scientist up until recent times. Anthony Flew, for the last 40 years, all he does is go from one college to another, and he lectures to the student body that there's no God. He's written 40 books, promoting atheism and attacking belief in God. Okay? He ran across a good Catholic scientist. They became friends. They started dialoguing. And Dr. Roy Varghese, who started giving him some of the arguments for the existence of God, ended up changing Dr. Anthony Flew, who's in his 80s, an accomplished professor who's written 40 books promoting atheism and trying to denounce the existence of God. Dr. Anthony Flew, he wrote his 41st book. You know what he basically said in his 41st book? He said, all my other 40 books, I was wrong. That took a lot of humility. He's in his 80s. He wrote a book, his 41st book, he said, all my other 40 books that I've been selling for 40 years, that there's no God, he said, I was wrong. That takes a lot of humility. Anthony Flew, this shocked the world because everybody looks up to him. He's like the Pope of atheists. Can you imagine tomorrow Pope Francis said, I don't believe in God no more? We'd go, what? We'd go crazy, right? Okay? Dr. Anthony Flew, when he came on and said that he believed in God, this shocked the entire world. Because he was like the Pope of atheism. Let's go back to what I wrote there. The reaction in the world press was monumental. Professor Flew said that the main driving force for his dramatic change in belief was the information he read in a book, The Hidden Face of God. And a book written by Roy Marghesi, who's a Catholic, The Wonder of the World. Professor Flew said that the latest biological research, now this is what Anthony Flew said. You want to memorize this, because when you're talking to an atheist and they say, why should I believe in God? You want to get this sentence memorized. Here's what Anthony Flew said. The latest biological research has shown, by the almost unbelievable complexity of the arrangements which are needed to produce life, that intelligence must have been involved. Professor Flew said that the scientific evidence points to, quote, an integrated complexity in the biological world. Anthony Flew told the Associated Press, my whole life has been guided by the principle of Plato's Socrates, follow the evidence wherever it leads. Albert Einstein, the most brilliant scientist in the 20th century, here's what he said. Here's what Albert Einstein said. This was chronicled October 26, 1929, Saturday Evening Post. He said, quote, unquestionably, no one can read the Gospels without feeling the actual presence of Jesus. His personality pulsates in every word. No myth is filled with such life. You know that Albert Einstein is the most respected scientist in the last 500 years, and he was a practicing Jew. He read the four Gospels, and he says, wait a minute. You read the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you know that this Jesus person is real and he's alive. Look what else Albert Einstein said about the Catholic Church. He said this a little bit after World War II. Because the Catholic Church, most people don't realize, was the greatest force fighting against Hitler to defend the Jews from complete extermination. The whole world was silent, but for the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church was undermining Hitler's every move. Albert Einstein and other Jewish scholars saw the way the Catholic Church was virtually the only voice crying out against Hitler during World War II. Look at what Albert Einstein said about the Catholic Church right after World War II. He said, quote, only the Catholic Church protested against the Hitlerian onslaught on liberty. Up until then, I had not been interested in the church, but today I feel a great admiration for the church, which alone has had the courage to struggle for spiritual truth and moral liberty. Close quote, Albert Einstein. Wall Street Journal, December 14, 1987, in an article entitled Science Resurrects God, they quote Albert Einstein saying this, quote, the more I study science, the more I believe in God, close quote. Einstein also said, quote, the harmony of natural law reveals an intelligence of such superiority that compared with it, all the systematic thinking of human beings is utterly insignificant. New York Times, May 3rd, 2003, page 23, states, quote, only about 1% of Americans describe themselves as atheists who have no belief in God, close quote. In fact, the 1994 Gallup poll states that 86 to 87% of Americans believe in the God of the Bible. Dr. Eberhard Denner, who wrote a book, is called At the Deathbed of Darwinism in 1904. He's a German writer. He published this book in which he shows that of the 300 of the greatest scientists of the last three centuries, 243 of these scientists were firm believers in God, and these scientists saw harmony between science and their faith. So of the greatest 300 scientists that have ever lived, ever, 243 of them believed in the God of the Bible. In 1980, Charles Darwin's theory of gradualism, which has species evolving one into another over billions of years, was actually rejected by a conference of 160 of the top scientific evolutionists meeting in Chicago due to the obvious and embarrassing lack of evidence in the fossil record. So what does gradualism mean? Gradualism means that there was slow, steady evolutionary change. That was rejected by 160 of the top evolutionists in 1980. And guess what? They never teach you that in public school. All this stuff right here, you'll never get this in public school. You'll never get this in college. You'll never get this in university. They hide this stuff right now, so they can brainwash you with all the lame arguments that you're not prepared to argue against because you still haven't heard the Catholic position like you're hearing it tonight. I'm arming you for bear with these notes. You'll never be fooled again by a charlatan atheist. In 1995, a book called Evolution, A Theory in Crisis. By the way, I have all these books in my library, so these are books that I have in my personal library because I've been studying how to argue against atheists for 25 years. Okay? So I've been burning my eyeballs because I know they're wrong, and I've redacted all my reading into these notes for you so that you don't have to spend your time reading 30 or 40 books. You can look at my notes and you can argue intelligently. But I have the sources there in case you want to look at them yourself. In 1995, a book called Evolution, A Theory in Crisis by the Australian scientist Michael Denton. This book argues that Darwin's theory of evolution has not been validated by one single empirical discovery of science since its first publication of 1859. And what makes this book of immeasurable importance is that the author, Denton, is not a believer in God. What about Karl Popper? He's an agnostic, he's a philosopher of science. He's also a Nobel Peace Prize winner in 1995. Here's what he says, quote, "Evolution is not fact, not even a theory nor scientific hypothesis. It is at best a metaphysical religious research program," close quote. The burden of proof is always on the one who asserts. An atheist says, there is no God. So it's up to the atheist to prove it. An atheist does not win by default if I can't prove the contrary. What I as a Catholic have is faith in God. An atheist has faith that there is no God. The Catholic position based just on science is more reasonable than the atheist. And those who hold to a naturalistic explanation for creation, they want you to believe that nothing times no one equals everything. I don't know about you, but I think that's crazy. Faith is reasonable. Atheists don't know how life came to be. Believers, we say that God created life. Actually, none of us was there. Since you can't freeze frame a past event, we can only know about a past event through circumstantial evidence. We claim as Catholics that God's existence can be proved beyond a reasonable doubt through the intelligent design of creation, most especially what we just call God's masterpiece, the human being. Now, here are three of the arguments when you talk to an atheist, an educated atheist. Here are the three arguments they'll generally throw at you. Here's their worldview. Number one, some atheists argue for what's called solipsism. What does that mean? They'll say, everything's an illusion. Everything's an illusion. Well, we know this is false. Why? Try walking across the freeway during rush hour blindfolded in Los Angeles and see if the cars are just an illusion. Okay? So we know that solipsism, you can cancel that theory out. That's nuts. Here's the second thing that they'll argue. Atheists will say, well, something, that's the world and everything in it, came from nothing. How do you argue as a Catholic? This argument is dead on arrival because it goes against what? The first law of thermodynamics, and it goes against the law of biogenesis. So what's the third way that an atheist will argue? Some of them will say, well, we believe that the material universe is eternal. In other words, it was always here, okay? Didn't have a beginning. What? This argument is dead on arrival because it violates the second law of thermodynamics. So the three arguments that atheists will give you are all unscientific. Atheists argue that you cannot see God, therefore God does not exist. But I want to remind you about this medieval axiom given to us by the great fathers of the church, St. Anselm of Canterbury. He said this, quote, God is known in his effects. God is known in his effects. We must keep in mind that God immeasurably exceeds his effects, and in no way can we come to know God perfectly just through the study of his effects. However, those effects do demonstrate that God exists as their ultimate cause. Ask an atheist, can you capture the wind and put it in a bottle? No. You can only see the effects of the wind on nature. Likewise, God cannot be bottled up for observation, but you can see the effects of God. It's called creation. Here's another one. When atheists say, but I can't believe in God unless I see God. There's a lot of things that you can't see, but yet we believe. I can't see electricity, but I see the effects of electricity. When I heat something up at my house in the microwave, I can't see microwaves. I can eat the effects of that cooked pizza after I nuke it for a minute. I can feel the effects of the microwave when it heats up my leftover pizza. There's oxygen. Can you see oxygen? No, but we're all breathing. We're inhaling and exhaling. We can see the effects of oxygen. We can't see oxygen. Even more. Take a physics class and they'll tell you that everything, all matter, is made of atoms, protons, and neutrons traveling at the speed of light, creating what we call matter. Can anybody see atoms, protons, and neutrons? No. What I see is a book. What I see is a cup. What I see are a pair of glasses. What I see is a bench. I don't see atoms, protons, and neutrons. However, that's what science will tell you if you look at all these things under a super microscope. So, not everything that you cannot... Should I say the truth? Just because you can't see something doesn't mean it's not there. Here's another thing. Angels and demons. We can't see them, but boy, oh boy, we can feel the effects of both of them. Let's look at the one Bible verse I put there in your notes. Wisdom chapter 13, verse 5. It says, quote, for by the greatness of the beauty and of the creature, the creator of them may be seen so as to be known thereby. Notice what the Bible just said right there. It's saying what I just told you, that God is seen by the effects of creation. That's how we see God, by the effects. Here's one. All of us believe in love. Well, have you ever seen love? What is love, 5'7"? 6'1"? 6'4"? 150 pounds, 300 pounds, 210 pounds? What's love? Is it Mexican, black, white, Asian? Have you seen love? I haven't. Have you seen them running across the street? No! None of us have seen love, but you feel the effects of love all the time. In marriage, in family life, with your friends, in your faith, you feel the effects of love, though you don't see love. So remember, when the atheist says, I don't believe in God because I can't see God, then say there's many things that you can't see, yet you do believe in those things. And so that argument is dead on arrival. Let's continue on my notes here. This is how God has revealed himself to us. We know that there's a God based on specific, special revelation. Number one, this is contained in sacred scripture. This is called specific or special revelation. Okay? We know about God, the details about God through scripture. There's a second way we know about God. It's right there in the notes. General revelation. When you go to the beach, you go to the mountains, go to the Grand Canyon, go to Yosemite, Sequoia, go to, again, you know, just Hawaii, Cancun. When you see beauty, Florida, wow, what a beautiful state. When you see aesthetic beauty, you just like, you take a breath, you like, it like overwhelms you when you see that type of beauty. You're seeing the effects of God. Creation screams that there's a supernatural, intelligent designer behind the aesthetic beauty that you're taking in with your eye. That's called general revelation. So we know that there's a God two ways. Specific revelation, the Holy Bible tells us, and I walk out the door and look at creation, general revelation. Those are the two ways we know that there's a God. Okay? Specific revelation and what you can see with your eyes when you walk outside and see nature, that's called general revelation. That's how we know there's a God. The intellect was made for truth. I'm going to give you three very quick ways to respond to somebody very intelligently. You could be drinking coffee and somebody says, hey, man, hey, Tony, why do you believe that there's a God? And instead of going through a long dissertation like I'm doing tonight, you can make it very quick. Say, I believe that there's a God because of three different things. The light of creation, the light of conscience, and the light of Christ. Let's see, what do you mean by that? Let me break it down. There are three ways we know that there's a God. Number one, light of creation. What does this mean? That God reveals himself through the material universe he created. In other words, the universe is the artwork of God, the divine artist. And just as we can learn a lot about an artist by studying his paintings, so we can learn a lot about God by studying his universe. This falls under general revelation. And the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 25, basically what I just said, that we know God through the light of creation. Second way we know there's a God. Second way, light of conscience, which means God reveals himself through the natural law, which is written in our hearts. So with our God-given reason, we can recognize the demands of the eternal moral law. Many people call this the voice of conscience, in which God speaks directly to their hearts. This also falls under general revelation. And the Bible supports what I'm saying in Romans chapter 2, verses 13 to 16. It says, we know God through the law that he's placed in our hearts. The third way we know that there's a God is through the light of Christ. In other words, God reveals himself through his son, Jesus Christ. So this falls under specific or special revelation. This includes both the sacred scripture and sacred tradition. So those are the three ways we know that there's a God. The light of creation, everything that we see out there tells us that there's an intelligent designer behind it all. Number two, the light of conscience. The fact that I know right and wrong, everybody knows right and wrong. We may not live by those standards all the time, but you know that killing is wrong. You know killing an innocent person is absolutely wrong. You know raping somebody's wrong. You know stealing something's wrong. How do you know that? God put that law in your heart. Man didn't put it in your heart. That's called the law of conscience. God downloaded that information into your heart. So every human being on planet Earth, we know what's right and wrong because God has placed his law into our heart. That came from an eternal moral lawgiver. And the last reason we know there's a God, God the Father, is because his son Jesus Christ came to planet Earth 2,000 years ago, took on a human body, and he told us that he came from heaven from his Father. And his Father is our Father also. Those are the threefold ways of knowing that there's a God. Let's continue. So for those who have not had the blessing and benefit of receiving specific or special revelation, or who refuse to accept it when it's presented to them, they have only the created material universe and the natural law to guide them. However, by examining the universe and the demands of the moral law, every reasonable person is able to know God's existence and power. Therefore, as St. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 2, even pagans have no excuse for denying God's existence. It's true that because of original sin, man's intellect has been wounded and often causes man to go astray in his pursuit of truth. But even with a darkened intellect, man retains great power for arriving at truth. This is why St. Paul held the pagans accountable for rejecting God in Romans chapter 1 and 2. I love what C.S. Lewis says about why he believes in God. He says, quote, "I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not because I see it, but by it I see everything else." So, another argument that's constantly thrown as Catholics, they're saying, well, if you guys believe that there's a God, what about all the evil in the world? This is one of the biggest arguments they throw when you go to college or high school. The bully professors will say, what about all the evil in the world? If there's a God, why is there so much evil? And furthermore, they'll argue, what about all the evil done by religion? So let's tackle that question. I will grant you that there is good religion, Judaism, Christianity, and bad religion, Satanism, radical Islam, for example. However, sometimes people in good religions do bad things. There's no doubt. That's a given. We're all morally weak and in some way, shape, or form. However, the fact is that secularists or non-believers have much more blood in their hands than believers. Let me give you some history. In the name of fascistic, totalitarian regimes governed by atheistic leaders and states, Stalin, communist Russia, who was officially atheist, was responsible for about 20 million deaths during World War I. That was an atheistic government. Mao Zedong's communist China, another atheist government, his regime killed about 70 million people. Hitler's Nazi Germany, another atheistic system and government, comes in a distant third with about 10 million murders, 6 million were Jews. Pol Pot killed about 2 million of his fellow countrymen in communist atheist Cambodia. I haven't even included the mass killings by lesser atheistic dictators such as Lenin, Khrushchev, Brezhnev, Enver, Hoxhaw, Nicolay, Kaosuku, Fidel Castro, Plutarco Calles, Kim Jong-il. Even so, focusing on the big four, Stalin, Hitler, Mao, and Pol Pot, these atheistic regimes and leaders have killed more than 100 million people in the 20th century. Now let's look at religion-inspired killings. Religion-inspired killings in the Catholic Church simply cannot compete with the murders perpetrated by atheist regimes. Taken together, the Crusades, by the way, the Crusades were self-defense wars against Muslim terrorists that were offensively attacking Catholic countries and Catholic lands to dominate them and turn them into Muslim empires. The Crusades were 8 self-defense wars that the Catholic Church was forced into. If not, the Catholic Church would have lost all her countries and all her churches and all her lands and all her peoples. In fact, if you want to know the truth about the Crusades, the Catholic Church started getting attacked by the Muslims about the 7th century. When did the Catholic Church start fighting back? 1095 AD. Almost 300 years after the Catholic Church has been killed systematically by Muslim terrorists. In fact, 90% of the Catholic churches were destroyed or turned into mosques in 300 years, and most Catholics were converted to Muslims in 300 years by force. Finally, a pope figured, you know what? There's going to be no Christianity, no Bible, no nothing if we don't defend ourselves. So Pope Urban II in 1095 AD finally called the Catholic men in Europe, say, are you ready to stand up for the church and defend Holy Mother Church? And the men said, yes. If it wasn't for these brave Catholic men, there'd be no church right here. You know what we'd be in right now? We'd be in a mosque. You wouldn't have a Bible in your lap. You'd have a Koran. And all you girls would have a burqa on. You'd be covered from head to toe. But thank those Catholic crusaders. Thank God that they stood up to those Muslim terrorists in the Middle Ages and fought back the Islamic invaders. Those brave Catholic men. That's what we need in the church today. An injection of that type of valor again amongst Catholic men. I continue. So taken together, the Crusades, the Inquisition, and the witch burnings killed approximately 200,000 people. Adjusting for the increase in population, that's the equivalent of 1 million deaths today. So these deaths caused by Christian rulers in 2,000 years amount to only 1% of the deaths caused by Stalin, Hitler, Mao, and Pol Pot in the last 100 years. These men that I just named were atheistic thugs, men who took their view not from a Bible, but from a secular view of society. 60 years ago, in a remarkable book called The Drama of Atheistic Humanism, Father Henry de Lubac exposes false humanism as well as its lethal consequences for Western civilization. The deliberate rejection of God, which is atheism, cannot be the road to authentic human liberation. Indeed, the contrary is the case. Contemplating the tragic history of the 20th century, St. Pope John Paul II saw with other clarity that the eclipse of God leads not to greater human liberation, but to the most dire human peril. Man without God is not more free. He's in greater danger. This is what St. Pope John Paul II meant by the culture of death. That is a world without faith in God, and this leads to governments and societies influenced by Darwinian ethics that promote the survival of the fittest. Well, what about suffering? Doesn't human suffering disprove the existence of a good God? Here's an argument posed by secular humanists. To put it briefly, Since God is infinite goodness, if he exists, there would be no evil in the world. But there is evil in the world, so God does not exist. That's the way secular humanist atheists argue. How do you respond as a Catholic? St. Augustine responds, he says that, quote, God allows evil to exist since in his omnipotence he can produce goodness out of evil. The Bible also answers that question about how can evil exist if there's a good God. Look at what Genesis chapter 50, verse 20 says. Well, let me give you the background of this verse, okay? This is said by Joseph. He was one of 10 brothers. His brothers sold him into slavery. They were jealous of him because he was gifted. So his brothers sold him into slavery, and they figured that they went home and told their father. They said, hey, Dad, some wild animals killed Joseph. We don't know where he's at. Well, his father obviously was crying. Isaac, his father was just lamenting. Jacob was his father. Jacob was lamenting and crying about the death of his son. And then all of a sudden, the Middle East goes into a famine. Into a drought. And the world power is Egypt. Well, Joseph had been sold into slavery to the Egyptians. But Joseph, the Pharaoh, saw that he had these gifts, so he rose to a position of power where this Jew, Joseph, became the second person in command of all of Egypt, second to only the Pharaoh. So when this famine hit the land, the Middle East, Joseph's brothers went to go beg for food over in Egypt. They went to go beg Pharaoh for food for the Jews. When they got there, they didn't recognize their brother that they sold decades ago. His brother's now, you know, dressed nice. He's older and stuff. And, you know, he's dressed like a king. He's dressed like a Pharaoh. So his brothers come up to him and said, "Sir, you know, we're poor Israelites and we're starving and stuff. And we'd like to come and know if you can be generous and give us some rice and some food so we can take back to our family, the Israelites." And Joseph looks at his brothers and says, "Hey, you guys recognize me?" Nope. They didn't want to look at him. They're like looking down. "No, we don't know who. No, we don't recognize you." So he goes, "I'm your brother Joseph, the one you sold into slavery. Remember? You guys tried to have me killed. I'm your brother." They were shocked. And look what Joseph tells them. Joseph could have had them all killed. He's the second in command in Egypt, the world power at the time. He could have had them all chopped in pieces. Look what he tells his brothers that sold them into slavery, betrayed them. It's right there in the Bible, Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. He says, quote, "Even though you meant harm to me, God meant it for good to achieve this present end, the survival of many people." That's what St. Augustine means by God allows bad things and he brings good out of bad things. Joseph, who was sold and beat up by his brothers and thrown in a ditch and sold as a slave, that was evil what their brothers did. But his brother was bought, sold to Egypt. He, from a prisoner in a jail cell, he rose to be the second in command next to the Pharaoh. Now, there's a famine in the Middle East, and now he's able to feed his brothers, his poor brothers who are dying, and his father over in Israel. He's able to give them food and water and sustain them through the famine. So what their brothers intended for evil, God brought something good out of that evil action. He made Joseph the second in command in the greatest world power at the time. Look at Romans 8:28 says about bringing good out of evil. It says, "We know that all good things work for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose." Look at this. I'm going to inject some words in there. We know that all good things, even cancer, war, AIDS, you know, leukemia, whatever, all good things work for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. Whatever happens in your life, God is in the business of taking lemons and making lemonade. You say, "Man, look at these lemons. This is terrible." God is able to take those lemons and make lemonade. God is able to take good out of evil. Look what it says in Nehemiah chapter 13, verse 2. The Bible says, "For they hired Balaam." Balaam was a Midianite wicked prophet. They hired Balaam to curse the Jews. "For they hired Balaam to curse them, though our God turned the curse into a blessing." Again, so God takes the curse of this wicked prophet and he turns his words into a blessing to the Israelite people. Here's my concluding statement for tonight. The world-renowned philosopher and convert, G.K. Chesterton, he said this, quote, "The theory of evolution will be one of the great jokes in the history books of the future. Posterity will marvel that so flimsy and dubious a hypothesis could be accepted with the incredible credulity that it has." Dr. Louis Bonnier, former director of research at the French National Center for Scientific Research, calls evolution, quote, "a fairy tale for grown-ups," close quote. In our American currency, you take out a quarter from your pocket, says everything one needs to know about this country. It says, number one, In God We Trust. That was put in our money in 1864. This refers to the Judeo-Christian revelation of God. Our money does not say, in Darwinian evolution, we trust. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I got 12 minutes. So I'm just going to take questions for a few minutes till 9 o'clock. I just want to let you know that last month's Bible study, part 1, and this month, part 2, on how to answer atheists, I went in a studio and I put them in a CD. So both of these talks are crunched in one CD. I have them back there in the hall. It's called How to Answer Atheists. So it got everything in there. It got 2 hours. I compacted them in 1 hour. I've been looking for this. About 25 years ago, I heard a presentation on the rosary. He's a friend of mine. He passed away a couple of years ago. It's the best explanation of the rosary that I've ever heard in my life. It's Louis Kazmierzak. He passed away a few years ago. I heard it when I was a young guy, and it changed my life about the rosary. Louis Kazmierzak, when he did it, he goes through the history of the rosary, and he shows the way Catholics prayed the rosary, all the historical things that have happened. Wars have been stopped. I mean, literally, he goes after one war after another. He names the people in the war that said we need to start praying the rosary during this war. One war after another, wars were stopped as a result of Catholics starting to pray the rosary. That CD, I just located it, and I made some copies, and I brought it over here. It's called The Power of the Rosary. Trust me, it is the best talk on the rosary I've ever heard in my life. If you know somebody that you want them to start praying the rosary, when they listen to this, they'll grab the rosary and start praying it every day for the rest of their life, because it's a historical CD that shows the power of the rosary throughout history in Western civilization and the many things that the rosary has accomplished. I'll give you one that most people don't know. This happened about 5 years ago over in Argentina. Okay? There's about 15,000 LGBT community organizers, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, anarchists, and they were going into the cathedral to go destroy the cathedral because the Catholic Church, you know, because they don't want to marry homosexuals and lesbians. So they went over there to destroy the cathedral. This is on YouTube, by the way. You can see this on YouTube. About 70 young guys, probably about between 20 and 30 years old, they locked arms in front of the cathedral, and they all pulled out their rosaries. And they just made a chain around the cathedral, and they started praying the rosary. You can see this on YouTube. About 15,000 on the other side, they're spitting at them. They're throwing stuff at them, different cups. And these guys, they stood in front of the cathedral with their arms locked, praying the rosary nonstop, and they were attacked viciously. And after about 15 minutes, the 15,000 rabble-rousers, anarchists that wanted to destroy the cathedral, they were all homosexual and lesbians, they ended up, after abusing them for about 15 minutes, they ended up leaving and walking away. And those 70 guys, I mean, these homosexual and lesbians were spray-painting them right in their face, and these guys wouldn't move, and they're saying, "Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee." You can see the power of people that pray the rosary in this CD. It's called The Power of the Rosary. There's a lot of stories like that. It'll change your life. I brought it. It's a hard CD to get a hold of, and I located it from the family of Louis Kazmierzak, and I have it back there. So we got a few minutes. Does anybody have any questions about atheism, about last week, about this week, that you want to just that you want to ask, or something that you're not sure about? Anybody? Yes.
I was wondering if you could explain the comment that the Pope made on Easter about more Christians. anxiety now than I think ever have.
Thank you for bringing that up. The Pope just made a comment over Easter that more Christians are dying right now than even in the early church, which is true. I read one news account that every 5 minutes, a Christian that's either a Catholic or a Protestant Christian is being killed by a Muslim terrorist in the Middle East or in Africa. Every 5 minutes. So how many is that in an hour? 12, right? Yeah, more Catholics right now are being killed right now, and Protestants too, than at any other time in history. The Pope just said it. He said it Easter Sunday. It's a factual statement. And I'm just telling you right now, the most hated people in the world right now are Christians, Catholics and Protestant Christians, those of us that believe in Jesus. In this country, they hate us. They're trying to pass laws that are encroaching against our Christian liberties. And here's what's going to end up happening. Because of all these anti-Christian laws in our country that they keep trying to pass and encroaching upon us, what's going to end up happening, two things. The Christians, Catholics and Protestants that stay in their churches, they're going to be the true believers in Jesus Christ. But the ones that are not real solid, they're going to say, you know what? I don't want any problems with the government. I'm out of here. They're going to leave. So a lot of Catholic churches and Protestant churches, they're going to empty out. People will say, I don't want no problem with the government, okay? If believing in Jesus is going to get me this much trouble, I'm out of here. So you're going to see a lot of Catholics, they're going to jump ship, and Protestants. But you know who's going to stay? The true believers. The ones that really believe. Good question. Anybody else? Questions, comments? Yes.
I have a comment. I experienced during the Lenten season, we were bombarded with a lot of information at our doors, even though our door has a sign that says we're Catholics. They were really rampant during the season. And it was unfortunate that I wasn't home to contest it. Otherwise, I would have had a good struggle there.
Yeah. You know, the Jehovah's Witnesses are the ones. They really go... During the Christmas season, they're really out there in full force. It's simple. You know, what you just want to do with the Jehovah's Witnesses. I think I gave that class a while back ago about when all the churches started. I gave you the sheet, right?
Yeah.
It's very simple. Just memorize this. Okay? When they knock at your door, say, they got a Bible, you got a Bible. Say, hey, brother, you know what? I'd love to talk the Word of God with you, but are you a Jehovah's Witness? Yeah. Okay, well, you guys, the Bible was put together, you know, by the Catholic Church in the 4th century. You guys were started in 1874 by Charles Taze Russell in Allegheny, Pennsylvania. Why should I listen to your organization about what this book says? Your organization started 1,500 years after the Catholic Church put the Bible. If I want to know what the Bible says, I'm going to go to that church that put the Bible together, which was the Catholic Church. So thank you very much. Here's a cold cup of water. Have a great day. God bless you. It's simple. Don't listen to any church that did not put the Bible together. The only church that put the Bible together was the Catholic Church. You remember, in fact, I brought that talk also here. It's called Introduction to the Bible. For those of you that weren't here, I go through the whole history of the Bible in detail. When it was put together, how they chose the books, the years it was put together. I brought that CD also. It's called Introduction to the Bible. And you just got to tell, that's what I tell everybody. Talk to Mormons. And sir, I'd like to talk about the Word of God. What do you know about the Word of God? You guys were started in 1835 by Joseph Smith. This book was put together, specifically, if you get my CD, you'll get all this, in 382 AD. By who? The Catholic Church and the Council of Rome. So, isn't it logical, if I want to know what this book says, I'm going to go to that church that put this book together. I'm going to go to that church that Jesus started, that gave us this book. Why should I go to a church that was started 1,500 years after the Bible was put together? Is that crazy or what? That's all you got to say to any denomination. I don't care who they are. Sir, God bless you. I'm glad you love God and believe in God. But I cannot give you the time of day. If I want to know what the Bible says, I'll go to my church and look at Catholic sources. We put this book together. Why are you going to go? It's like, why are you going to go to, for example, to the Republicans to find out what the Democrats believe? No. Why are you going to go to the Democrats to find out what the Republicans believe, right? Go to the actual source. The Catholic Church put the Bible together. It's our book. No other church existed before, you know, Luther broke off from the Catholic Church in 1521. Some of you remember that Bible study I gave, right? I hope you have the notes that I gave you. I get excited about this stuff because I hate when they lie to Catholics. One more question. We got 2 more minutes. Yes, sir.
I think it's important to also mention the Orthodox that are also being slaughtered.
Yes.
In full communion with us.
Let's remember that in the Middle East and in Africa, remember I told you before, we've been through this before, there's 3 types of Christians in the world. Catholic Christians, Orthodox Christians, they broke away from us in 1054 AD, and we've already been through all this. Protestant Christians, they started in 1521. So every Christian falls under either Catholic Christian, Orthodox Christian, Protestant Christian. Guess what? You know who's being slaughtered in the Middle East and Africa? Catholic and Orthodox Christians. It ain't Baptist, it ain't Pentecostals, it ain't Victory Outreach. None of those churches are over there. They're not over there. They're here. They were started in America. The Christians that are being slaughtered over there are Catholic Christians and Orthodox Christians. Those are the oldest Christian churches in the world. In fact, the oldest Catholic churches, I think, that are even older than Israel are in Iran. There's like 3rd and 2nd century Catholic churches in Iran, which is the land of the Old Testament, by the way. Much of the Old Testament happened in Iran, which is right next to Israel. So just remember, you can stop, you know, just to make it brief, say this. Somebody knocks at your door, say this. You know what? I love God. I'm a practicing Catholic. I love his son, Jesus Christ, as my Lord and Savior. This book, I love this book. It was given to me by the Catholic Church. It was put together by the Catholic Church. I thank you for knocking at my door. You want a cold glass of water? Here you go. But I don't want to hear what you have to say about this book, because your church didn't put the Bible together, and your church was not started by Jesus Christ. I hope you have a great day. Thank you very much. God bless you. Be nice. But don't listen to somebody else whose church was started by a man. Listen to the church started by Jesus Christ. Amen? It's this church. This is the only church started by Jesus Christ. And that's a fact. I'll leave you with this. I tell Protestants this all the time. You want to see which church was started by Jesus? Simple. Buy a ticket and go to Israel. Simple. And when you get off there and you're taken by a tour guide all over the land of the Bible, you're going to be saying, where's the Baptist church at? Where are the Mormons? Where are the Jehovah's? They're not there. They're all American churches. You walk into the land of the Bible called Israel. Guess what you're going to see all over the land of the Bible? Like measles, Catholic churches. And the tour guides, if they take you, you're going to go from one Catholic church to another and say, and here's where Jesus was born. Guess what you're going to walk into? A Catholic church. And here's where Jesus performed his first miracle, the wedding feast of Cana. Guess what you're going to walk into? A Catholic church. And here's where Jesus Christ, you know, multiplied the loaves and fishes here in this. Guess what's right in that spot? A Catholic church. Why? We're the first church. And the Israeli government is very jealous. They don't allow man-made churches over in the Middle East, in Israel. That's holy land. They don't let some Johnny-come-lately, I just got out of prison, and I'm going to start my own, you know, Pastor Pete's Pentecostal church here in Fillmore, and I'm going to start one in Israel. No, no, no. You can start it in Fillmore. This is America. You can do what you want here. They're not going to let you start that in the Holy Land. The Holy Land says, nope, only the old religions come here. The ones started way back then, thousands of years ago. The Jews, Catholics, the Orthodox, and Islam, the only religions there. All right, I'm done. Thank you very much. God bless you. We'll see you next time.